Good afternoon, Mr. Sanjay Jain, and welcome for your this exclusive interview with the Indian Textile Journal magazine.
Hi, Rakesh. Good afternoon. Pleasure to be interacting with you.
So to begin with, Mr. Jain, can you just brief us about your role in PDS multinational fashion and also an overview of PDS multinational fashion business, along with a background of manufacturing facility, the capacity, and in general, the overview of the company?
Yeah, I'm Chief Executive Officer of the company based here in Mumbai. And that's my role. And about PDS, PDS is a digital tech-enabled plug-and-play platform operating in the apparel sector, catering to the world's largest retailers, trying to cater to their apparel needs. And what we have built at PDS as a platform is today generating, basis our last year accounts, we generated about 6,213 crore of sales. That's approximately $840 million. And generated about 150 crores, about $20 million of profit. And it has been a tough COVID year, but the company has done fairly well. But coming back to the business we do, as I said, we cater to the customers, retailers, and to their apparel need. And PDS is actually, for all practical purposes, a multinational company. While we are listed here in India on NSE and BSE, but more than 95% footprint of the company, both in terms of customers as well as the origination of sourcing, is actually outside India. We have close to about 50 offices in across 22 locations across the world. And in terms of markets where we sell is largely UK and rest of the Europe. That's about 80% of the market. North America is about 8% plus of our market. And I think you name the large customer that is operating in these market, PDS is catering to that. And on the origination side, or on the sourcing side, we actually source our materials from Bangladesh, which is about 60% of our procurement. Then China, about 10%. We have a decent similar size procurement coming in from Turkey, Sri Lanka, and then Vietnam and India. And we have close to 500 vendors approved, from not just from a technical competence perspective, but also from a environmental, social governance, compliance perspective. So that when we cater to a customer, the entire value chain is ESG compliant. And we have about 150 designers, in the locations which are more closer to the customer, whether it is London or Germany or Turkey, wherein the designers interact, very much with the customers in terms of visualizing the trends, converting the trends into designs and samples. And through our tech-enabled global supply chain, we get them, manufactured and supplied. In terms of, when I say, $840 million of sales last year. Just about less than 10% is what we actually manufacture from our own facilities. And 90% we actually get it done from our approved vendors. And as I said, to our customers, we actually take an end-to-end responsibility to make sure that the origin from where it is coming is actually fully compliant, that responsibility on ours, and managing the whole supply chain of bringing it to the designated location advised by the customer is a responsibility. PDS also has a unique model wherein I would say we are an entrepreneurial company. We actually, while there is PDS on the whole wherein everything gets aggregated, but at the same time, we work through, special purpose vehicles, SPV, mm-hmm. we call it, which are actually not just SPV, it's actually business entities wherein, an entrepreneur would actually be setting up that company PDS would own the majority stake, and then the entrepreneur brings along with him or her, you know, an understanding of the customer, understanding of the sector, and that energy level to create value. Then PDS, as I said, through its platform, which is what I started with, that we are a plug and play platform, wherein over a period of time, we have invested into, you know, various functional skills like HR, IT, legal, finance. We have got $340 million of banking limits from world leading banks, credit insurance, you know, so an entrepreneur, you know, doesn't really have to bother too much about arranging all these things. He can just come, plug and play. Of course, PDS is diverse. So we have policies, guidelines in place, you know, and therefore on the whole, we have 40 plus such entities wherein we have an entrepreneur, you know, on an average, say 25 to 30% share is with an entrepreneur. So that brings in tremendous amount of scalability. It brings in tremendous amount of agility, you know, as well. So to sum up the, you know, first part of your question, what PDS represent today is a plug and play global platform. It is an asset light model because, as I said, we take the responsibility of an end-to-end serving to a customer from origination to supplying to the customer location. But at the same time, we try and do it in a capital light model. That's somewhere also reflected in 22% return on capital employed of the company, which is way higher than any, you know, traditional model of manufacturing and then selling. And third point is we are a design-led, sustainable and responsible sourcing company. We have strong financial and risk management capabilities in place. Over the last 21 years of effort, we have now invested into capabilities which enable us bring the right product into the right market and bring it from the right factory, you know. And lastly, in terms of a brief of the financial performance, our board meeting was actually last week wherein the board considered and approved the financial results for last year. As you know, Rakesh, it was a COVID hit year.
Right.
And retail and apparel sector got probably most, you know, affected.
Yeah.
But PDS, through its agility, nimbleness, actually done well. On one hand, we managed to arrest the decline to a very small extent, you know, just about average 10% as compared to previous year. But at the same time, in the last quarter three, quarter four, we actually started growing. In fact, quarter four sales of ours are 9% more than the quarter three sales. So we managed to, you know, stay very much actively engaged with the customer. And therefore, the top line happened. And then we focused a lot on our cost structures. And we actually brought down 15% reduction in the costs. You know, despite commodities heating up, we managed to stay, you know, managed to keep a margin, gross margins intact.
Mm-hmm.
So gross margin intact, arresting the decline in top line, you know, cost structure cutting. As I said, we are a asset light, you know, company. So we actually focus on our net working capital. We brought it down from 10 days to 5 days. Therefore, the finance cost reduced by 50%. As a result, Rakesh, I'm very happy to report, if I have to sum up performance in two parameters, we had 80% plus growth in earnings, you know, COVID here last year, and our return on capital employed actually increased from about 16% year before that to 22% last year.
You already have, you know, touched upon the, my first, you know, question on, you know, you have grown about 83% growth in the PAT in a COVID hit year. And you also, you know, touched upon the reasons for it. Would you like to share more about the secret of your success in this, you know, in a very, very, you know, constrained kind of an environment?
Well, there are no Rakesh secrets per se. I think we just carefully executed what are the age-old principles of doing business. You know, no, we didn't avoid risk ever in our conduct. We always work towards mitigating the risk, proactively managing the risks. So for any organization, the number one key dependency is the ability to sell to a customer. So we have been very carefully engaging with our customers. You know, we are not just a technical supplier to a customer. We are partners. We try and work hard to be partners. At the same time, from a risk mitigation perspective, no single customer is more than 6% of our, you know, average, on an average basis, top line of the company. We see that when we do business, then there is adequate credit insurance available, you know, for the receivables. So as a result of it, during the COVID year, many retailers got impacted, but because of the risk management principles of PDS, you know, it could, if at all I can use the word, we actually could totally avoid any hit coming to us. And Rakesh, this didn't happen last year. The foundation of all of this was laid in many years before that. Secondly, as I said, we're entrepreneurial company, you know, and therefore when you're an entrepreneurial company, then your agility and nimbleness is there. So when COVID happened, we could all muster our collective thought process and actions together to bring the cost structures down. And we brought it down to, you know, by about 15%. And third and fourth, COVID led to emergence of some trends, you know, which was in e-commerce, increasing its share in the distribution, right, you know, which the customer was buying. It led to casuals, coming in a strong more than actually formals, you know, almost replacing formals to a large extent. Functional clothing starting coming in. So PDS was very agile to adopt to these trends, you know, as a result, kind of have a decent top line, you know, mitigating or avoiding the impact of the overall decline. So that's somehow how we could, manage. And lastly, since, as I said, our roots, our foundation is an asset-light model and a constant focus on that, bringing the working capital down, also led to interest costs coming down as well. So I think, as you can see, there are no secrets to doing it. It's just about staying focused on execution in terms of the old age principles of doing business.
Are you, like you also mentioned about your 95% of your sales as well as your supplies are outside India, if I'm correctly. So that also in a way help you to, especially when it comes to your, you know, sales point of view, because what we are seeing is domestic industry of textiles is getting hit more and the companies who are export dependent are able to generate more revenues. Is that analysis right?
See, Rakesh, we should look at it, the market, the global market, Indian market, in terms of immediate context of COVID and without COVID. So if I just take COVID out for a minute, it's globally a $2 trillion apparel market and nearly 25% is in, you know, in UK and Europe, and about 20% is North America. So if you are building a global company, a global scale company, then these two markets are 45% of the, you know, global market. So therefore they offer you size and scale, you know, but these markets on an average are growing, you know, a low single digit percentage on an average. Whereas India is a small market, very small market as compared to these markets, you know, but it's growing the fastest at 12%, you know, because we are a young nation, our GDP is growing, young population, you know, aspiration is going higher. So many reasons that you and I would agree that India is fastest growing market. That's how I would say without COVID, you know, that can you close eyes to India as a market? The answer is no. But can you build a large scale in Indian market? It'll take many years to get there, you know. But if you have a large scale coming in from the European, North American market, then our economy of scales improve. Our ability to cater to the low cost, low price points of India goes up. India is relatively, you know, a low price point market as compared to the markets we cater to. But now if you bring in the impact of, you know, COVID into it, I think the markets that we cater to, Rakesh, are gradually coming out of it. I think COVID is still out there. All of us are cautious. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows what's there in the future. But if you go by, you know, the vaccination percentage, you know, then I think North America is doing fairly well. UK after a lockdown opened up in April, and UK is the largest market. Mm-hmm. So therefore, for any company, whether PDS or any other company, if these are the main markets, they are in a much better shape.
Right.
But if any company, India is a key market. Currently, we are, you know, all of us are severely impacted by COVID, you know. But I think that's a short-term thing. Hopefully, with all the measures being implemented, vaccination improving, it's a matter of time this market will also start, you know, opening up. Mm-hmm. But for now, if destination is Europe and North America, I think that company is relatively better placed. You know, and for us, even our procurement, you know, has been to a large extent coming in from outside India. While I think government of India has rolled out some nice measures in terms of 7, you know, STPs, and there are some profit link incentive schemes as well. You know, so India's attractiveness as a location to start manufacturing is increasing, but at present less than 5% of what we procure comes in from India. So if Indian supply chain have got impacted because of COVID in the current month and the previous month, then our business has been largely insulated from that as well.
So are you looking at increasing sourcing from India, especially against the context that the government has brought in certain kind of an incentives for increasing the domestic production of textiles?
So I wouldn't say we have, you know, kind of made any firm plans that I can share that, yes, we have decided to invest. But what measures have been announced, you know, are attractive, you know, and PDS is carefully evaluating. I think at this juncture, Rakesh, with COVID out there, preservation of capital carefully, you know, is the need of the hour. So we are evaluating it. I think it's surely worthy of an evaluation.
So, you know, what kind of changes you are seeing in the consumer behavior, behavior as well as the buying pattern due to COVID-19, compare it to say pre-COVID era?
I think 2-3 things, as I also briefly touched upon earlier, that the online being used as a medium to purchase has increased its penetration immediately after COVID. In the key markets where we, you know, sell, as I said, Europe, UK, North America, the penetration in the apparel sector was about 20%, you know, around there. And in during COVID times, it actually went up to 30% or so. You know, so that's one behavioral change, that instead of buying through a physical interface at a retail store or a shop, the buying was more shifting, you know, towards e-commerce or so. But whether that is a permanent trend that has been set in, it is too early to say. I think as human beings, we always have to touch and feel, you know, but that's the answering your question. That's the first trend that changed. COVID also led to, you know, almost all of us working from home, and it was more a casual wear than actually a formal wear, you know, so social gatherings reduced. So more casual wear came in as well. There was more functional clothing. There were opportunities of doing PPE equipment and, you know, kind of opportunities came in. So these 2-3 trends have actually, you know, emerged during the COVID times. And one trend which I would say has been there prior to COVID as well, which is gaining more and more strength, is the compliance, sustainability part of it as well. But that has been there prior to COVID, but it is only gaining more strength with time passing by.
So at present, from your procurement point of view, how many manufacturing facilities are operational globally for you?
So as I said, we have close to about 500 plus, approved partners globally. And I just touched upon they being spread across Bangladesh, China, Turkey, Vietnam, Sri Lanka, and to some extent India. Now, Bangladesh is the biggest piece. Well, Bangladesh has been impacted by COVID, but there is a lot of focus by the government on the apparel sector and also the related supply chain. So I would say for all practical purposes, every vendor partner of ours in Bangladesh is functional, you know, and so is in China and Turkey. Of late, there have been some increased incidents of COVID in Vietnam. So that is impacting, you know, the manufacturing and supply chain there. But that's a small percentage of our, you know, maybe just about 3 to 4%. So if I have to say the larger pieces, Bangladesh, China, Turkey, Sri Lanka, I think on the whole, our vendor base is largely, you know, fully functional.
So what are the key challenges before the global players, suppliers like PDS right now?
I think I would say there are a lot of opportunities, Rakesh. Mm-hmm. I think, as I mentioned, COVID impacting retailers, customers, and COVID impacting a lot of the vendors as well. You know, the ones who were relatively highly leveraged because of COVID significantly impacting the cash flows. I think those companies got impacted. But PDS, as we touched upon earlier, because of his, you know, principles of proactively managing risks, has done well. In fact, our net debt, you know, is significantly down. Our net debt to EBITDA is 0.3. So we actually done very well. But when I say, you know, opportunities, then PDS is now, you know, carefully, you know, understanding the environment and assessing if there are consolidation opportunities that PDS can lead. COVID has also led to, you know, more, you know, digital brands or D2C brands, you know, that's with the e-commerce coming in. So that's an emerging trend, you know, and with COVID being there, the interface with technology, you know, like 3D tools, you know, sampling, 3D sampling, virtual showrooms. So the IT has a lot of role to play. And so I think I touched upon the IT part of it, and I touched upon the digital brands part of it. And thirdly, which is an increasing requirement, which PDS 100% respects, is the sustainability part of it. So I think these three are going to be important, you know, focus areas. They are the expectation of the ecosystem around us, you know, and PDS is really gearing up for that.
Are rising prices of fibers and yarns a concern for you?
Well, the prices have, you know, been, I think, rising. They rose about 25%+. But I think after a peak in February, you know, they have actually come down by about average 10% or so. So I think because India got impacted, India is a major buyer of, you know, cotton yarn. And as a result, you know, the consumption getting impacted. So the prices have softened a bit. But that's one thing to, you know, observe. At the same time, as the market is opening up, there's a strong demand. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a pent-up demand of, you know, since March 2020. So there's a strong demand as well. So these are the two things. On one hand, you have input prices that have risen. They have softened a bit. On the other hand, you have strong demand. So we have been carefully engaging with our customers. You know, we're carefully engaging with the vendor partners. You know, our scale offers also the opportunity of getting the benefit of scales. As of now, Rakesh, as we reported our results, we have managed to keep our gross margins intact. You know, the gross margins last year versus the previous year have been pretty much similar. You know, so I think it's we are watching it out. You know, we are keeping an eye on it. And carefully engage with our stakeholders, customers as well as vendors, to see how we can mitigate the impact.
You also just now mentioned about sustainability. You know, gaining. You know, is a buzzword now across the world, including textile brands globally. They are demanding, you know, accountability in terms of green and carbon footprint from their suppliers, and also looking at concepts like circular economy. So how is PDS helping them in their green journey?
In fact, this is a very, very big priority for PDS. You know, sustainability, including compliance and ethics, as I mentioned earlier, is one of the key building blocks of PDS platform. You know, and if anybody asks us to introduce, you know, PDS, then mentioning about this particular building block is a key integral part of PDS platform. And we have been having a keen focus on promoting sustainable materials, you know, and low impact manufacturing. And in fact, investing in a sharing circular economy. Post the board meeting, PDS also announced an acquisition of a company called Yellow Octopus. You know, it's a leading company in Europe. You know, we acquired 50% stake, and it's providing, commercial sustainability solutions to fashion industry. So what it does is it works very actively with the global retailers, you know, and brands, and try and, bring the, whatever doesn't get sold to actually the Eastern European part of the world, to small retailers, etc. And therefore try and address the need of, properly in an environmental compliant manner, getting rid of the unsold inventory, return products, and that's the recent investment that we have made. And earlier as well, we have been, as I said, very actively. In fact, Matera is another investment in UK that we made. You know, it focuses on sustainable materials, a technology that allow company to grow cotton using 80% less water, So that's not the activity we are doing, but we are investing a part of our, investable surplus mm-hmm. into a company which is focused on sustainability, So therefore, PDS, in fact, former capital employed, close to about, if I just take the real estate offices, etc., close to about 8 to 10% of a capital employed is actually getting invested into, technology that is going to have a significant impact on the future of the retail sector, and also the circularity part of it. So that's PDS contribution, in terms of continuously investing into it.
So how do you analyze the performance of Indian textile industry in terms of its global standing and also the competitive landscape of the global market?
See, the for Indian market, as we touched upon, besides the local markets growing up at a faster pace of average 12% expected rate of growth, the big consumption of apparel in the world is North America and Europe, and so Indian exporters have also been eyeing on those markets, but those markets have been getting catered by China, by Bangladesh, by Sri Lanka, by Vietnam, so wherein scale, tech costs have been very, very important, parameters for a customer to consider. Of course, in addition, the compliance with the ESG part of it. So I think because of some benefits, that the other competing neighboring countries enjoy, at present they have a more larger share of supplying to the global consumption of apparel. China, Bangladesh, Vietnam are the big ones, But with the recent, policy changes that I mentioned to you, or the benefits in terms of the mega 7 textile parks, that the government has launched, and also the, performance linked incentive schemes, that have been there. So that would also now allow the, Indian garment manufacturing as well as exporting companies to now, bring their cost structures down in line with, the overall expectations that customers are getting catered to by the neighboring countries. And it will also allow scales, when you are getting access to world-class infrastructure to set up your facilities, then you also get motivated to set up scales and then bring the costs down. I think what's also important, Rakesh, is the supply chain. While manufacturing is one thing, but how efficiently, seamlessly you are able to get your output closer to a doorstep of customers, is very important. In India, still a predominant part of our supply chain is road transport dependent, which is relatively an expensive, mode of transport. So as the country on the whole is committed to improve the infrastructure, so there is one piece which is related to the core textile manufacturing, apparel manufacturing through the textile parks, through the performance incentives, and then this whole supply chain improvement as and when it happens, plus the local market, the domestic consumption is going to go up as well. So India as a local market will also be a sizable scale. I think therefore these three things, when they come together in medium to long term, India's competitiveness, you know, as a manufacturing location, and then able to cater to this global demand is going to improve, you know. And that's where in one of the questions that you asked earlier to us, as I said, while for now, less than 5% of our, you know, sales are actually originating from India, but we are keeping a close watch on all these things that are, you know, gaining traction in terms of India's attractiveness as a manufacturing location.
So India, if you look at it, is very strong in the cotton based supply chain.
Yeah.
While its contribution in the global market for man-made fibers is very meniscus.
Yeah. So,
and also the other emerging market, rather you can say, the technical textiles. So how do you see these two, you know, segments being, you know, impacting or being affected positively for Indian manufacturing? How can India take a lead in these two sectors, rather, put it simply?
I think I touched upon the aspects in when we say man-made fibers, when we say technical, you know, aspects. These are relatively capital intensive. You know, you invest into manufacturing facilities, you know. So when there is a textile park, then you get motivated to invest more. And when you feel that, yes, my cost of production, there's a large scale, my cost of production is down, but there is an infrastructure around me which is seamlessly allowing me to do inward of material and seamlessly and cost efficient manner allowing me to do the outward of the finished good, you know, then that the moment the industry start seeing these things, there'll be more investment and India's competitiveness, you know, will improve. And I think if at all China one plus policy, you know, is to be assessed, I think then India's attractiveness only goes up. So I'm not saying we are going to benefit just because there is a China one plus policy. Our own internal initiatives, you know, are key. So the two things that you touched upon are, this is a labor intensive sector, but they are more capital intensive tech, you know, investment. So as the environment is being made conducive through a policy framework to otherwise, one would see more investment, you know, coming in.
So does inverted duty structure is also one of the aspects which is affecting this industry, where you have the GST or duties on raw material higher than the output, and that is within the raw material also cotton is taxed at a lesser rate, while your MMF has been taxed at higher rate, and because of its residence in inverted tax duty kind of a thing. So is that also a very key factor?
Well, Rakesh, I will very briefly say this is that industries in general and PDS in specific have been investing into creating a model, you know, which is sensitive about the duty structure, but at the same time it is not dependent on duty structures. But so, you know, I think what we got to focus on is our efficiencies, you know, of the processes, our responsibility of compliance, etc. And I think have a faith in the government, you know, in the fiscal system, that over a medium to long term, it will always move in a right direction, you know. And I think now it is not just about a local country. Now you have regional bodies, you have global bodies, which try and bring parity, you know. And I think we are a believer in that. So okay, we continue to focus on the basic processes, and as I said, with the belief that duty structures will keep correcting themselves.
So what are the emerging trends in the textile industry globally?
I think number one, as I said, brands and retailers, Rakesh, are looking for higher standards of compliance, you know, with huge shift towards sustainability, promoting sustainable materials, and using, you know, recycled raw materials, you know, and low impact manufacturing. and then reducing the carbon footprint. You know, so these are some of the aspects which all fall under the gambit of, you know, sustainability. That's very, very important. You know, and at the same time, the suppliers need to comply and sign up with our retailer, a specific customer's ESG goals as well. While there is an overall, you know, need or to comply, there's also a specific customer's goal that we need to cater to. And therefore, you know, you got to be a strong partner to your customer. And not only for this compliance or circularity, but also for another thing called digital brands, which I touched upon. You know, that's the direction, you know. And also there is, okay, another third thing is, there's a growing market for smart textiles, you know, the performance wear, you know. And then there is functional clothing, for example, for medical, surgical, special needs, you know, etc. So how importantly and how with agility and effort we are engaging with our customers. And lastly, you know, the IT tools, as I said, like 3D sampling, you know, and then virtual showrooms, 3D fit, you know, using AI-driven demand forecasting softwares, you know, also getting traction. So, and so are we, therefore, as a company, catering to our customers, eventually catering to the consuming individuals, you know, sensitive about it, proactively engaging, you know, investing into it. I think PDS has been very focused on all these aspects. So therefore, these are the emerging trends. And I think we are carefully gearing up, working towards these emerging trends.
So last question, you know, what are your short-term and long-term growth plans?
See, our growth, our main markets, as I said, have been UK, Europe, and US. And I think UK, Europe is about 80%. We have been increasing our share of the top line from North America. We'll continue to stay focused on that. We are there with large customers when it comes to apparel. You know, we want to now get the relationship broadened up, you know, to do more business. So we're trying to add home textile and other categories. You know, so therefore, I think in the very short term, Rakesh, if we all talk about a huge pent up demand, you know, taking real shape as COVID goes away, I think PDS is geared up to cater to that. If online penetration has happened and is here to stay, PDS is geared up for that. So we see our quarter one order book, for example, has been strong. So we expect that a kind of, you know, 8 to 12% growth rate is a maintainable growth rate in the short to near term, you know, with companies placement across, you know, 22 countries with 50 offices. And as I also touched, Rakesh, that we are careful about the emerging trends on the digital brands. We are careful about the consolidation opportunities. You know, PDS has a strong financial position. So can we carefully evaluate those opportunities? So that's the near term to medium term plan for us.
Thank you, Mr. Jain, for your time and sharing your insight on the company and also the industry. It was a pleasure meeting to you.
Likewise, pleasure, Rakesh, interacting with you. Thank you, and have a good day.
Thank you, Mr. Jain. Thank you.